Hello to all, and today I'm delighted to bring to you a rather incredible video report because we are going to talk about a major breakthrough in watchmaking history, a mechanical revolution, as simple as that, and this was accomplished through the combination of human genius, creative thinking, and the power of modern technology. The LVMH brands, under the supervision of Mr. Jean-Claude Biver, are currently pooling their R&D resources, and what we see today exemplifies this majestically, I must say. So this revolution is first seen in a Zenith watch, the Defy Lab, and this comes in a certain way as a tribute to the incredible chronometric legacy of the brand, but it will soon be industrialized and implemented not only for Zenith, but also in other collections of the LVMH watch brands, and maybe others too, and I will get back to this at the end of this video. But before going into detail, let me very, very quickly remind you how a watch functions and think about it as a three-stage machine. First, you need energy, and this one is stored in spring barrels. Then this energy is passed on and activates gear trains onto which watchmaker will add time reading displays, such as hands. And finally, you have the regulating organ, which ensures the regularity of how this energy is liberated. The smoother, the more regular, and the more precise your watch will be. But I've said that we're talking about a revolution, so let's go back in time in 1675, in fact, when Dutch mathematician and scientist Christian Huygens presented something that revolutionized watchmaking science with the introduction of the regulating principle that bears his name. Despite that, there were a few others that had worked on this, but nevertheless, he got the fame for it. So the main feat consisted in what we still know today regarding regulating organs, meaning the combined role of the balance wheel and its characteristic hairspring and the escapement transforming this energy previously mentioned in the oscillating and regular movement, the tick-tock. And in French we say tic-tac, never understood why there was a difference, but let's go back to the subject of the day. So, for more than 300 years, watchmakers have been using this same mechanical principle, adapting some parts here and there, developing more complex systems, such as the tourbillon, for instance, using new materials, but this Huygens principle remained the same until bada-boom today. And you can definitely grasp that this is something really revolutionary and special, as you can see this impressive number of journalists that turned out from all around the world to attend and witness this launch, and of course Mr. Biver's enthusiasm to share this fantastic achievement.
We are the future of Swiss watchmaking, and we are going to show it to you, we're going to prove it to you. Together! One family, one synergy, one help, and we have nothing to hide, and we have everything to share. That's the mentality.
Watchers TV, well, you know you can count on us to bring you something a bit special, and we had the great opportunity and privilege of discovering this in a more private manner a few days prior to this official launch. So off we went to La Chaux-de-Fonds, where we met Mr. Guy Semon and his team. And just as a little side story, I've known Guy since many years with one of my previous occupations, and initially it had nothing to do with watchmaking, as we were discussing opportunities related with aviation and some kind of clever aircraft time-sharing business. But at the same time, the company for which I was working was developing what has become the Tag Heuer Monaco V4 with the replacement of some of the gear trains with some kind of microbelt system. It was kind of a strange company, don't need to go into details, and we were facing enormous difficulties with this V4 development. It was fine on paper, but a true nightmare, a mess when translated into a mechanical object. And Guy was made aware of this, and kind of out of the blue, he came with solutions that made it possible. Without him, this would have been unachievable. And from this initial contact talking aviation to discover the scientific genius he was and still is, was quite a surprise. Life is full of nice surprises. Okay, but now enough, and let's talk about some pretty serious technology. Well, first we had the chance of listening to the full story of this development by Guy himself, before going to the lab part and dive into some kind of unusual environment for us compared to the more traditional watchmaking workshop we're accustomed to. He explained to us how he challenged this Huygens regulating principle by using technological developments seen in other fields of science. He really pointed out the fact that in a certain way watchmakers had remained between themselves since centuries, and it's really not too long ago that engineers were involved in watchmaking. We're talking like the last 40 years approximately. But initially the brain power of these engineers had mostly been used to optimize existing production processes, and this is where his vision sets him apart, as he brought in engineers and scientists within the actual timepiece movement development process and had them cohabit and complement watchmakers. So with this came new and fresh ideas, not polluted by tradition, and I don't say this in a bad way, but just people that came with a totally new approach to things and opened the door to the transposition of scientific concepts successfully used elsewhere, and in this case coming in particular from the world of optical science, quantic optic, to be more precise. In this field of science, observing what happens at the atomic and molecular level requires to be able to measure immensely small increments of time. We are talking the femtosecond. That's 10 to the power of minus 15 seconds. That's a billionth of a millionth of a second. And to give you an idea, there are more femtoseconds in 1 second than seconds since the start of our universe. You know, the famous Big Bang, dare to Mr. Beaver. So this is the playing field of these scientists, and they use very special oscillators that can measure these electromagnetic waves. And this is where it becomes very interesting, because the equations and models used to achieve this are transposable to the world of mechanics. It's the same formulas, but transport to a new field of mechanics called compliant mechanics. Prior to this new form of mechanics, we were accustomed to think that the deformation of an object was the result of a force applied to it. But with compliant mechanics, this deformation is now seen as a property of this object, and this changes everything. With this new approach, the 11 connection principles of mechanics can be redefined and replaced with the deformable elements. Okay, I hope I still have you with me here. I know it's a little bit geeky, but has to be done. So taking all these ingredients, Guy Semon and his team have managed to use this science and modelize a completely revolutionary mechanical oscillator made out of one single silicon component, and its shape, geometry and behavior is a direct result of these extensive calculations. Of course, the computer power required to do so didn't exist before, but nevertheless, it's this out-of-the-box thinking that is first and foremost what made it possible. So instead of having a minimum of 30 components for the construction of a classical regulating organ, you only have one now, so less weight, and since you don't have any more contacts or frictions, well, one of the immediate benefits is that it naturally uses less power. So approximately 3 to 4 times less than a regular timepiece. And by consequence, you gain quite some extensive power reserve. But the benefits don't stop there. With the normal balance wheel, the amplitude with which you obtain the best isochronic performance is set at approximately 300 degrees, meaning that your balance wheel goes back and forth on 300 degrees. But with this new approach, this amplitude is much less and set at less than 5 degrees, so going ever so slightly from one side to the other. And science has shown that minimal amplitudes has a big impact on performance. Think of the pendulums and the ones shifting from one side to the other over a very small distance are more precise, or like Guy would say,
le sinus de l'angle theta est inférieur à theta.
Okay, lost me there, but if he says so, well, that's fine with me. So once this new regulating organ was produced, they mounted it on a classical movement, well, just slightly modified in order of having it on the front side of the watch to see it better, of course. I mean, you don't want to hide this. And you can also see pretty well how the silicon escapement wheel interacts with it. Additionally to this, and since one of the issues with silicon is that it can break quite easily, this new regulator is trapped between two extra layers, like a sandwich, that protects it from vertical shock. But let's now listen to some of the team members that participated in this really incredible project, and I know that the team might seem young, But I can promise you that there is quite a super high level of brain power there. Very impressive, but mainly very inspiring.
So this approach with this new oscillator and new escapement is to make the anchor and the oscillator into one piece where every motion, the whole kinematics is made by flexible parts instead of traditional mechanical joints. You don't have any more solid friction in your axis, so it allows the damping of the oscillator to be a lot less. And this can be a great improvement for the energy consumption and the precision of the watch. Also, since it's not made in one part, you can really optimize every bit of this part to get the best of the computer simulations.
And talking about the frequency of this oscillator, what are we looking at now?
The current oscillator has a frequency of 15 Hertz.
And how do you measure the precision of this watch then?
So since it's not a traditional Swiss lever escapement, and it's also at a frequency that's non-conventional, we have to build our own measurement system. And we have this setup here that was custom made to measure these special watches.
Avec ce mouvement, vous venez poser l'oscillateur sur le mouvement de base, et puis voilà. Vous avez beaucoup, beaucoup moins de pièces. 30 pièces sont éliminées. Vous n'avez plus d'anti-choc. Voilà, il y a beaucoup de problèmes qui sont résolus. Et donc, vous laissez beaucoup moins de chance au hasard. Voilà, il y a beaucoup moins de points à contrôler et donc une meilleure fiabilité. On a trois réglages. Donc, on a deux excentriques et un réglage en plus pour l'avance-retard, comme sur une montre classique. Donc, les deux excentriques vont nous permettre à la fois de rapprocher l'ancre de la roue d'échappement et le deuxième excentrique va nous permettre d'augmenter ou de diminuer le repos qu'on a au niveau de l'ancre et de la roue d'échappement. Donc, ce sont deux réglages qui sont largement suffisants pour faire fonctionner très correctement l'oscillateur.
Another advantage of this system compared to a classical regulating organ is that you have very small differences of amplitude depending on where you stand in terms of your power consumption. The way your spring barrel liberates its stored energy changes quite radically after a 24-hour period. The linearity is broken, and this implies that today's super accurate mechanical watches achieve a plus or minus 1-2 second performance over 24 hours. That's already pretty damn good if you consider that a day is made out of 86,400 seconds, but after this 24-hour period, precision tends to drop because of the variation of this energy throughput. With my watch, I can clearly see this. That's a cool aspect of it. When it's fully charged up, I see the balance wheel beating at a certain pace. And when the power is low, well, the amplitude of the balance wheel isn't the same anymore. But I'm fine with it. That's no problem with that. Okay, with this new system, this phenomenon is totally reduced. And the precision remains the same of plus or minus 1 second per day, whether you are in this first 24-hour cycle or after it, since this watch has a power reserve of 70 hours, and this represents a true novelty. So 10 models of this revolutionary Zenith Defy Lab timepiece made public today have been produced, and if you're interested, well, I'm sorry to say that they have all been sold. But as mentioned previously, the goal is to continue the development and broaden significantly the usage of this technology in additional models, and this will be introduced starting in 2018, and not necessarily only for Zenith. Other brands such as Tiger and probably Hublot will most follow, and maybe even brands outside of LVMH in a later stage. So we're talking real production capabilities, and despite all of this coming from fundamental science, well, it's great to see that it's now applied science to new disruptive manufacturing processes. And as we were there, well, Guy Semon showed me a few extra things his team is working on. Too soon to reveal anything, and of course we didn't see everything either, but I really have to say that I was immensely impressed with all what I saw. I mean, we're talking super high-end technology with some super brainy people. This is no side joke, this is raw brain power at its best. This is science fiction meets tradition, Silicon Valley meets the mountains, and you guys know my respect and love for traditional watchmaking, but to see it witnessed that there are still so many innovations to be achieved in mechanical watchmaking is just fabulous and complementary to all these other watchmaking endeavors we love to bring to you. And therefore, I guess we'll still be there for quite a while without ever repeating ourselves with our videos. That's pretty cool. And I just have to say a very special message for all of you speaking French, because on our website, you will find the full speech of Guy Semon, link in the description below. And not only is the man simply brilliant, a real genius, but on top of it, he's a great storyteller. And the way he explained us the development of this major innovation is a pure pleasure to listen to. So there's nothing fancy with this video, no crazy editing. Look at it as a reference document, because he just marked history. Yeah, simple as that. And he explains it in a very simple and inclusive way, just what I love. So for those speaking French, well, enjoy this one too. And if any of you have the courage to translate it, well, I guess many people would appreciate. So I hope you enjoyed this video as much as I enjoy making it. All the very best to you, and see you real soon. Thanks for your time.